Good morning. Welcome to Trading Hour. It's a Wednesday morning. Things have been steady, through the course of the morning. We're higher now for the fourth day in a row. So, Sonal, on Thursday, the Nifty closed off at levels of about 23,900. And now we've climbed close to about 650 points from that level as the markets are now, closer above that 24,500 mark. Banks are outperforming for the second day in a row. The Nifty Bank is up nearly 3/4 of a percentage point. And there are so many individual stocks like these recent IPOs like Enviro Infra, Niva, Bupa. These are stocks which are up 20% in the last 2 days. Swiggy, Ola too have been making some solid gains. So the broader market is very, very vibrant and active.
It is. And you spoke about the recent listings, right? That has been the flavor for last 2 days.
NTPC Green Energy.
Yes, even the that one is doing really well. And you know, two names from the broader markets, which I highlighted yesterday as well during Midcap Radar, HEG and Graphite. So HEG is up another 12%. We have Graphite, which is up around 6%. So we'll have to figure out what's really happening with these names. But the uptick continues. The realty space also, second day running, is seeing higher levels. So Nifty Realty, that is one of the top gainers that we are tracking today. And apart from that, the small cap index continues to do well, 0.4% higher there. But it's really about the financial space and it's really about the banking space that continues to do well. So let's put focus on that. PSU banks are buzzing ahead of the RBI monetary policy on Friday on hopes of a potential CRR cut. And Citi has written a note on how this move could impact banks. Abhishek is here with the details.
Well, Citi has written on banks. They have tried to analyze the implication of a potential CRR cut, especially given the fact that there are improvement with respect to prospect of repo rate reduction as well. So they say that RBI could consider a phased reduction of 25 basis points each in consecutive policies, that is two policies. So durable liquidity has reduced to more than rupees 2 trillion in just 1 month because of substantial forex operations that's being carried out by RBI. So a reduction in CRR from 4.5% would be a normalized process to go towards a pre-COVID level of 4%, and that would mean a release of more than rupees 1 lakh crore liquidity into the system. So CRR cut can be viewed favorable with respect to HDFC Bank, Axis Bank, Federal Bank, as well as Bank of Baroda. A 50 basis point repo rate cut that would give an NIR return negative, which would impact the highest to Federal Bank, as well as HDFC Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank and Axis Bank. It would have lower impact on some of the PSUs like SBI and PNB, up 2.8 and 2.7% impact on their NII. Lenders who will not have adverse impact from rate cut is IndusInd Bank, AU Small Finance Bank and RBL Bank on their NII momentum. Rate cut could benefit sooner for some of the NBFCs like LIC Housing Finance. 58% of their debt is from market borrowing, so a rate cut would mean immediate transition of reduction in the cost of funds. Bajaj Finance as well, 48% of their debt is from market borrowing. L&T Housing Finance as well as MMFSL. Back to you.
Thank you very much for that. Let's move on now. Swiggy is surging close to about 5% following positive management commentary after their Q2 numbers. Mangalam is here to tell us the details and what he took away from the management commentary. Mangalam.
Well, so the key takeaways from the numbers post, the basic numbers itself tells you that Swiggy is on its path to improvement, where the food delivery business operational metrics continue to improve with operating leverage, and quick commerce continues to grow because of the investments that the company is making in it itself. So food delivery in the second quarter, the EBITDA grew by about 2 times. Margins came in at 1.6% versus 0.9%. And Bolt, which is a recent innovation, 10-minute food delivery, is now about 5% of their sales itself. On Instamart too, the orders jumped by about 21% quarter on quarter. Orders per dark store increased by about 10%. And the companies announced that they will double their dark stores itself by March 2025 itself, and the average size of these stores increased by 30-35% as well. In the conference call, they spoke about profitability. Profitability on a consolidated basis by the third quarter of FY26. Food delivery business, they believe, can grow at a steady 18-22% on a GOV basis, and improvements in the margins from 1.6% could go all the way up to 3%. On a steady state, the company believes this can actually be at around 5% as well. And in the quick commerce business, EBITDA breakeven comes in at around the second quarter of FY27 itself. The good part about Swiggy is that we already have a precedent in the form of Zomato, and as a result of which, the path that Zomato has taken, Swiggy is following in that itself. At current price, Swiggy is trading at around 50% discount to Zomato, as against 60% at the issue price itself. Further narrowing the execution timeline gap between both of them would narrow the valuation gap between the companies as well. In fact, this morning we spoke with the management, and this is what they had to say to us.
Factor of how well our efforts at creating new use cases as well as creating affordability work. We have a series of new use case related work that we're pushing out to the consumers, the latest being Bolt, the 10-minute food delivery that is expected to create some new consumptions. There's things that we've been doing on affordability, but we'll continue to build on it. I think how well we do these few things are going to really dictate whether it'll be the lower end or the higher end, I guess.
There is operating leverage that is already existing in the business. If you look at over our last four quarters, we've added 90 basis points in EBITDA just on scale, right? And you should expect a similar kind of number to play out even with the rising scale. And there are opportunities on the take rate side, advertising business. We have talked about it, having another 100 basis points of leverage existing still, and some of the cost equations, especially on the subscription program, which we have successfully run over time. We do expect leverage to also come through the overall affordability initiative that we have launched. So you should assume that it's a good trajectory, and steady state is not very far away. So if you look at, three out of the top seven cities are already profitable. And within these cities, 75% of the stores, which are say 12 months and above, are already profitable. So as we kind of guide for accelerated store expansion, there is going to be the certain investment that will be baked in for the overall neutrality at the corporate level to come by in four quarters from now. In terms of the overall cash balance with the IPO proceeds, we have a little over 8,800 crores in bank. So it's a very, very strong balance sheet. As we have said in the past, a lot of this is actually defensive capital to ensure that we continue to have the firepower to continue to remain invested in the category growth. Food delivery business is already generating positive free cash flow and will continue to accrete to the corporate treasury. So overall, we feel a very good place from our balance sheet strengths point of view, and we don't expect to raise new capital in the near future.
Okay, that's Swiggy. The stock is up 2% and not 5%, as I said earlier. And Zomato, too, is up nearly 1.5%. So it's pretty much a stable duopoly now in the market. There's one stock which is getting affected by Q-commerce's dominance and aggression, and that's DMart. So this is an interesting note which has come out from IFL, where they're saying that DMart is no longer the go-to destination for the most affordable daily groceries. So it's not the cheapest option. So they did a recent survey, and that shows that Flipkart is offering grocery products at a 3-4% discount to DMart. Zepto, through the Super Saver program, and even Flipkart's quick commerce venture, Minutes, is now offering pricing which is 2% lower than that of DMart Ready, and even Amazon's Fresh pricing is now at par or comparable to that of DMart. So basically, this is showing that DMart's once unquestioned dominance in terms of a price advantage may now be fading, which is why IFL is not very bullish on Avenue Supermarts. They have a reduced rating, and the target price is pretty much where the stock is currently, at 3,800. But interesting, numbers coming out from the recent survey about how peers are now offering groceries at a cheaper rate compared to DMart.
Oh, yes. So that has been a conversation for a long time as well, yeah. Right? How Qcom has been impacting Avenue Supermart, something that they've spoken about in their post-results commentary as well. But with that, we'll slip into a break now. Up next, we'll discuss what's buzzing in the commodity space with Manisha Gupta. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're still tuned into Trading Hour on CNBC TV 18. Now, while equity markets are doing well, let's talk about commodities now. Manisha is joining in now, and today we are focusing on crude oil prices. Manisha, what's happening here?
Oh, well, yes. Finally back above $70 a barrel after trading below that level for almost 2 weeks is what we've seen for WTI. Overnight has been 2% of gains, and this is after U.S. has sanctioned 35 Iran entities and vessels. Also, the markets have seen a bit of a gain ahead of the OPEC and allies meeting on 5th of December. This is online in Vienna. with an expectation that the output cuts could perhaps get extended for a third straight time this time. Also, China is preparing for 2025 economic targets. China manufacturing also is expanded for a second straight month into the month of November. So all of those are supportive factors. And then market is pricing a 75% chance now of a 25 basis points of a rate cut in the month of December. That is yet another thing which has led to decline in US dollar index and gain in many of these dollar denominated commodities. Well, the markets also will watch out for the Powell speech that is happening today. You have the US non-farm payroll data that is on Friday. And then it is about China stimulus measure expectations via China Economic Work Conference that is happening next week. So there's plenty to watch out for before we end this 2024.
Thank you, Manisha. As always, get into a break. On the other side, Vinod Agarwal, MD and CEO at VECV, will join in on the other side to discuss the November auto sales for the truck and the bus business.
Congratulations.
Congratulations to CNBC TV for doing 25 years and all the best for next 25 years.
Welcome back. Now, Eicher Motors is the next stock which is currently on our radar right now. The company's November sales came in muted but largely in line with street expectation. The pressure continues in the higher range of truck segment, while the lower range truck and bus sales have seen some improvement. To talk more about the numbers, we have with us Vinod Agarwal, MD and CEO of VECV. Mr. Agarwal, thank you very much for joining in. So while on a year-on-year basis, we are seeing a pickup in the overall numbers, month-on-month, there is a fall. So this month, we are at about 5,600 units. In October, it was 7,100. In September, it was 7,600. Are we seeing a slowdown per se? And what can you guide for the full year?
First of all, I think in the commercial vehicle sales, it is never seen month on month because November is traditionally a lower month. October is festive month, and numbers are higher. September is also first half end, so therefore numbers are higher. So November, if you compare with the previous year November, then the situation is not so bad. So therefore, I will not take it as a sign of that the industry is not growing or it is going to go down based on the month-on-month figures. Okay. You have to look at year-on-year. And year-on-year, as far as we are concerned, we have grown by 7.5% in November, even though our sales were just around 5,500, but we have grown by 7.5% as compared to November of last year. Similarly,
Go ahead.
Now, I was saying that even the industry also, year on year, for the month of November, the industry was flat. It was almost same numbers as were there for the last year. But then, of course, that was driven more by the buses growth. The growth in buses in November was 33% as compared to previous year November. Whereas there has been a drop of around 4-5% in heavy-duty trucks, similarly around 4-5% in light and medium-duty trucks. So, therefore, the figures are driven by growth in bus sales. So based on that, year on year also, the industry overall 3.5 ton and above, that is down by around 2%, and whereas we have grown by 2.6%.
Okay. So looking at your numbers then on a year-to-date basis, right, about 7 months in, your total sales are up 2.6%. Domestic sales are only up 1.3%. So is this low single-digit 1, 2, 3% kind of growth expected for the full year, FY25? And what is the expectation for the industry, your company and industry?
As far as this overall performance of industry is concerned, I think this year the industry has not done as well as was expected in the beginning. Of course, there are reasons. One is that the traction in the infrastructure investments that has been slow to take off. And now, of course, we are expecting that there is going to be a lot of action in balance 4 months, because if we have to catch up with the expenditure on infrastructure projects for the Government of India targets, I think a lot of action will be there in these balance 4 months. And similarly, you will see more buying happening based on that. So therefore, balance 4 months, we are expecting that there will be better growth in the industry. However, at the same time, last year also, these 4 months were very strong. So therefore, maybe there will be a little bit marginal growth only, because last year also base was high. So overall, you will see this year will be a sort of a, you can say, a stagnant year, or full year will be very, very marginal growth. And as far as we are concerned, we will do slightly better than the industry only, because first 8 months also we have done better, and balance 4 months also we expect to do better. However, at the same time, the growth figures, you also have to see with respect to the tonnage growth. Even though the numbers growth doesn't look so well, but if you convert it into metric tons, based on the capacity of trucks that are sold, I think there is a good growth in the metric tons, because a lot of migration has happened to the higher tonnage trucks. Like, for example, a lot of migration has happened to tractors, which is 55 ton. Similarly, in the light and medium duty trucks, a lot of migration has happened to 18 ton trucks, which is medium duty trucks.
Right.
So that migration, the overall tonnage growth is there, even though numbers growth look to be very, very stagnant.
Okay, we get that point. Mr. Agrawal, hold on to that thought. There are important flashes at the bottom of our screen. The announcement with respect to Mr. Devendra Fadnavis being the chief minister for Maharashtra is expected very shortly, because his name has been proposed in BJP core committee meet today. So we will be expecting that announcement shortly, and that is an important update, something that the Maharashtra government has been talking about for a while after the election results, and there had been no clarity on who would this chief minister of the state be. But it looks like today there could be a final name that could come out, and it looks like it is Mr. Devendra Fadnavis would be named as the Maharashtra CM shortly. So we'll keep updating you on these important political updates as far as Maharashtra is concerned. Mr. Agrawal, let me come back to you. You spoke about you'll grow faster than the industry, and second half is when you're seeing that capex, which would come back the last 4 months, would be strong as well. So Ashok Leyland in the quarter two call had mentioned that they're expecting an industry growth in the second half to be around 6 to 7%, and full year to be around 0 to 3%. Will you do better than these numbers? That is what you mean. And what would the overall CV outlook be for the business?
Hopefully, if you look at our track record, we would like to maintain the same track record. So first 8 months, we have done better than the industry. Industry had dropped by 2%. We have grown by 2.6%. So I think we would like to keep the same track.
So you will do better than the 6 to 7% industry growth that your peers are expecting?
6 to 7% looks to be difficult, as I mentioned a little while back. It will not. The growth will be less.
No, I meant in the second half, Mr. Agrawal, not for the full year, but for the second half.
Second half also, like first 2 months has been very muted numbers. Okay. First 2 months, October and November. So, and as I mentioned last year also, the 4 months, the base was high. Like, for example, heavy duty trucks. Last year, December to March, it was 100,000 units sale. So this year, these 4 months, I'm expecting it will be almost similar, maybe 100,000 or 105,000, which will be just around 3-4% growth. Or similarly, the light and medium duty trucks. Last year also, it was around 40,000 units sale in December to March. So this year also, it should be around similar. So therefore, last year also, these 4 months were strong. So I am expecting it will not be a very high.
But so far this year, you've grown 2.6%, while the industry has degrown 2%. Yes. So there has been good outperformance. So why is buses doing so well? You know, you've spoken about it in the past as well, and that momentum in buses continues. So what's driving it, and will it extend, say, to FY26 too?
Buses sale are driven by, first of all, the schools. Schools are buying more and more, and tier 2, tier 3 cities, there are more buying of school buses. Similarly, the staffing segment has come back because work from home is almost gone now. So a lot of people are now started coming back to offices, and a lot of buses sales are happening for staffing segment. Then intercity segment, the coaches sale, that also has come back. The state transport undertakings have started buying. That's why you see very, very heavy growth in the bigger buses. Heavy duty buses, the growth is much, much higher. It is almost 50% growth. When we say growth of overall YTD growth of 22% in buses, out of that, the heavy duty trucks growth, buses growth is around 40 to 50%. That is based on the STUI. So these are the factors which are driving the buses growth. And I am expecting next year also will be good growth in buses, because you will also have some more buying in the electric buses. So therefore, buses segment will remain strong.
This 22% is for the industry or for you? The expectation of...
I was talking of the industry. We have buses, we have grown by around 12%.
Okay. All right. Take that point, Mr. Agrawal. Thank you so much for joining in with all those details and the outlook going forward, most importantly for the industry and for the company as well. With that, we'll do one thing. We'll slip into a break. When we return, we'll discuss market technicals with Mitesh Thakkar and also talk about his top trading bets.
For 20 years, it has been India's most coveted stage for business leadership. The benchmark of unparalleled excellence.
We have to dream big and even bigger for India.
An accolade that celebrates character, integrity, and decisive action.
You just have to do your best.
Not identified by any single name, nor defined by a single achievement.
The best years are to come, and you don't have to wait for long. It's round the corner.
But redefined every year by visionaries who inspire and legends who lead. A journey that honors those who set the bar higher year after year. This is not just an award. It is a celebration of leadership in action. CNBC TV 18's 20th India Business Leader Awards.
Welcome back. You're still tuned into Trading Hour, and one of the stocks that's on our radar today is Oberoi Realty. It's surging in trade. Nomura has initiated a buy on the stock with a target price of 2,500 rupees a share. The stock is right now at around 2,150. They expect solid pre-sales and cash generations, and they expect the company to be looking at aggressive business development. Now, do remember, last 2 years has not seen major launches come by, but now Nomura sees some addition to their business development pipeline, because of which pre-sales could witness a 40% CAGR over FY24-FY27, with 50% plus embedded EBITDA margins as well on some of these projects, because there would be high-end luxury projects. The cumulative hotel and annuity revenue could record a 35% CAGR over the next three financial years. And they're also expecting cash flows to improve. So around 3,000 to 4,000 crore per annum until FY27. This is before the new business development or annuity asset investments come through. So this is all before investments, the cash flows. Of course, there could be some deduction from these levels, but these are good numbers that Nomura expects from Oberoi Realty. And that's why that's big surge that we are seeing on the stock right now. With that, let's move on and talk about technicals of the market. Mitesh Thakkar is joining us just for that. Mitesh, what's the next important level to watch out for in the Nifty and your individual picks?
Yeah. So I think getting past 24,500 to me is a positive. I think one, we should now sustain about 24,460. And very likely that in the next few days, with some volatility, we'll head towards 24,770s, 24,800 zone. So the idea should stay positive unless until we see the Nifty break below levels of 24,460.
And stocks?
So on the individual stock side, I think, you know, the PSU banking lot is looking good as well as the IT pack. So I've picked up a TCS, which is a buy with a stop at 43.45, look for targets of 44.50, and Canara Bank, which I would recommend buying with a stop below 104.5, targets of 111.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Mitesh, for joining in as always and taking us through your technical picks. With that, we'll slip into a short break. When we come back, we'll discuss market fundamentals with Devang Mehta from Spark Private Wealth Management. Stay tuned to that. Welcome back. You're still tuned into Trading Hour on CNBC TV 18, where markets, they continue to trade higher. 90 points of an uptick that we're looking at for the Nifty right now. So steady at the 24,550 mark. What's doing well, of course, is the Bank Nifty. That is the one that is supporting the gains that we're seeing on the benchmark as well. In the broader markets, we have some of these names, the likes of Honasa, which after that big fall is making a comeback. We've seen that the promoter group has bought some stake, Varun Alag, that is. On the back of that, that stock is higher by around 10%. The Graphite India is higher. We do have some of these names like UCO Bank, Central Bank of India, IOB, some of these PSU banks, which are doing really well in trade. And let's talk about Aurobindo Pharma as well. That company's name tagged in news related to Auro Infra and Kakinada Seaports. They are doing, there is a clarification which has come in, and they say that they're in no way connected to these two names, and that's why there is a recovery on the stock after this clarification that has come by from Aurobindo Pharma as well. We'll, of course, get more details on this one. But for now, let's get some some fundamental conversations going on the markets. Devang Mehta from Spark Private Wealth Management is joining us now. Devang, good morning. Thank you so much for joining in. Well, that's the next question. Now that the first half of earnings disappointment is over, what's the outlook for the second half? You're almost done with most of the quarter three, data as well. What have the conversations suggested that you have had with corporates?
Good morning, Sonal. Thanks for having me on the show. Pleasure to always be on CNBC TV 18. I think very clearly we are past that earnings. There was a narrative of earnings downgrade. There was a narrative that money would flow towards U.S. risk assets after the New World Order, after Trump was elected. Also, I think the thing that money would flow towards China, that has also sort of waned away. It just happened for a brief while. And then again, I think after this correction, and that correction which was seen because of one, the earnings not meeting expectations, and second, of course, we saw the GDP print, right, which was more a lag indicator for the markets. Yes, you are absolutely right that I think people have now again sort of shunned that. That in the next couple of quarters, the earnings are bound to come. We know that around 7 trillion rupees would be spent by the government in the next 4-5 months to again spur the infrastructure and the capex that was slowed down because of the general elections, the state elections, and many such events in the last 7-8 months. I think the next 4 months, we would see a lot of capex, private capex also coming back to the fore. I think the marriage season, the wedding season also, what we are talking about is again going to see a lot of consumption coming back. And I think if you hear a little bit of green shoots from the rural economy is where a lot of people are also talking about. The lot of corporates which we met are saying that yes, that there was a time of that the last quarter was a bit of a hibernation, but I think I was very encouraged by the commentaries, the positive commentaries of companies who are in the capex universe, or companies who are talking about growth plans as well. And I think everything seems to be on track. So my sense is after this 10% correction, we have seen 5% rise again. I think this is good time again to go back to the drawing table, look at the sectors and themes, revisit them. And again, I think it's good time. Maybe somebody, probably there will be a couple of months of time correction more. But I think no problems emerge as a larger type of problems for the market.
But is there a risk that this expected recovery in the second half of the year doesn't play out? So much of the heavy lifting in terms of an expected pickup in capex, green shoots in rural consumption. What if it doesn't play out? Is there a risk to that? What have you heard from the corporates?
So, of course, there are always two parts to it. And you can probably look at the optimistic part of it and say that the recovery will happen. But yes, the question is absolutely on the right track, that if it does not happen, I think, yes, then maybe a bit of valuation correction, a bit of time correction. Yes, earnings, probably we talk about 8-9% type of single digit earnings growth for this year. Which is for FY26, there is still expectation of 18-19%. That may be pruned to around, say, 14-15, mid-teens type of an earning expectation, which may lead to a 4-5% correction more on the market side. But yes, it may again. I think the times that everything and anything would do well to be over, the time of easy money seemed to be over. Now one has to be very, very focused on the quality of earnings, on the quality of growth, and most importantly on companies which are generating free cash flows. That is, I think, going to be a paramount importance, that everything and anything would not do well. You have to be very, very picky and choosy about what theme and what businesses particularly you are going to buy. So yes, there is risk, probably a downside risk, if the recovery on the rural side as well as the recovery on the capex side does not happen.
So what are you looking at buying right now, Devang? We have seen that fall, but there's been a recovery from the lower levels as well. Any segments that you think are still looking reasonable?
I think, yes, most of our segments, which we have been very positive about in the last 1.5-2 years, we're not seeing any correction because of the market momentum we saw. But I would not say thankfully, but we saw some correction in some of the segments. We have been extremely bullish on something in power automation, power ancillaries, a company like Hitachi Energy, which I talked about on your show, I think at least 3 or 4 times. We like the business after seeing a correction of 20-25%. The company is right now at an EPS of 22 rupees, and the EPS is going to go to around 180 rupees in the next 3 years. This is one theme we are extremely positive on. We are very positive on engineering / manufacturing type of themes, stamping and lamination type of companies, engineering companies. ER&D has been one of the segments that we have been bullish on. EMS is another segment. I think these are segments which are linked to manufacturing, segments which are linked to FDI, segments which are linked to PLI. I think this will do very well. Another business which immediately comes to mind is something called port infrastructure, right? Port end-to-end logistics. We have been positive on a company called JSW Infra since some time. And I think this is a company which is sort of growing at 35% on the revenue side in the last 3 years, 34-35% EBITDA growth. It's being looking at inorganic acquisitions, doing a lot of end-to-end logistic work. I think these are the segments of the economy where if the GDP growth is going to bounce back, if capex is going to come from either government or private, I think these segments will do well. Apart from it, yes, you can't forget the consumption universe, which has gone through a bit of correction, a bit of, discretionary consumption, travel, themes like travel and tours, themes like aviation. I think these are segments one should look at. We are not buying all these themes, but yes, some of those are on the radar as well.
Okay. Any clear avoids for you for the next 6 months?
I think the sector somehow where there would be a lot of global dependence, I would not say it's a complete avoid, but on a case-to-case basis, if there is a lot of dependence on China, for example, we don't know the trajectory of China, whether it is again going to slow down or there is going to be some recovery coming back. So sectors like metals, where somebody has made a huge, huge sort of money, can probably be on a little bit of sideline. Again, I'm saying that 6 months to 1 year, there can be cyclical recovery. But for a 3-5 year horizon, you can avoid sectors which have huge global dependence. And something which is domestic centric will find more favor in our type of portfolios.
Okay, all right. Take that point, Devang. Thank you so much for joining in today with the fundamental outlook on markets and specific sectors as well. That's the word coming in from Spark Private Wealth Management. Time for a short break now. When we come back, we'll get you more on the markets on the other side.
sharp insights in the political arena to all the excitement from the world of sports.
We are here at the Siemens TV18 budget headquarters as we've done for the last 25 years.
Celebrating 25 years of CNBC TV18.
Welcome back. There is news coming in on Bajaj Auto where they've cut the price of Freedom 125, which is their CNG motorcycle. They had launched it just a couple of months back in July and August. So within 5 months of launch, there is a price cut in Freedom 125. The entry-level variant price has been cut by 5,000 rupees, while the price of the mid-level variant has been cut by up to 10,000 rupees. Now, this is what UBS has picked up, and their take on this is that since launch, Bajaj has dispatched nearly 80,000 units to dealers, while the Vahan retails stand at just 34,000 units, which explains the price cut. They go on to say that even select Pulsar variants have seen price cuts post-Diwali, and therefore there is a potential downside risk to the street estimates. So Bajaj Auto is now reacting to the news flow. The stock is down close to about 1%. Just in case you tune in, Bajaj Auto has cut the price of Freedom 125, which is the first CNG motorbike, by 5,000 rupees for the entry level variant and up to 10,000 rupees for the mid variant price. And this has been launched within just, this has been cut within just 5 months of launch. Now, according to UBS, the reason for this perhaps could be that the company has dispatched 80,000 units to dealers, while the Vahan retail stands at about 34,000 units. So maybe, you know, because dealers are sitting with inventory, that's the reason why they're looking at some price cuts. But even post-Diwali, prices of Pulsar, select Pulsar, not all of them, select Pulsar variants have also been cut. So not good news for those who were suggesting that the uptick, the little bit of a recovery that we saw in Diwali is lasting post the festive period as well. The stock continues to fall and now is down more than about 1%. Just take a look at if some of the other auto companies are also seeing a bit of a reaction to this development. Hero MotoCorp will come up for you on your screen. Hero MotoCorp is also down 1%. There you have. Hero MotoCorp is also down at the day's low. And there was a bit of a fall once this news flow came out. This is what UBS has picked up. Just yesterday, 2 days back, we had a chat with Bajaj Auto post the November sales numbers. And they said that the festive season started off slow, but then it picked up. And by the end of it, it was pretty solid. But now, maybe this is an indicator of either excess inventory or perhaps the demand being not as per what they were anticipating. Well, that's Bajaj Auto and the latest news flow there. For the markets, it's 24,530 on the Nifty, 70 points higher, a third of a percentage point gain on the benchmark indices. We're going to take your leave on Trading Hour from the entire team. Thank you for watching.
Markets are betting big on affordable housing. Look at the kind of stocks that have risen.
We are stepping into our Silver Jubilee year, our 25th year, and we wanted to have the best of India Inc. with us.
Celebrating 25 years of CNBC TV18.